Right, I've got the go. So let's get started. Welcome again to the event, How Can We Save Humanity from Climate Catastrophe? There's a lot to talk about, and we have a fantastic panel here tonight to share their insights into what is becoming, of course, an ever hotter issue. So we've got about an hour, and we will be discussing, amongst many things, what the state of the play is in the climate crisis, what can be done to get us out of it, and what is blocking the path to a clean, green future and climate stability. I'm sure we'll also talk about what impact the war in Ukraine, soaring energy costs, the cost of living crisis, and tense geopolitics are having on our efforts to cut CO2 emissions. Now, some of you have already sent questions in advance to our speakers, so thank you very much for those. We've had a lot. If you would like to put a question now, you can do that at any time. Just click on the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen, and we'll try and get through as many as we can in the second part of the hour. If you require closed caption, that's available too. You'll find the icon at the bottom of the screen. Now, let me introduce the panel. They're all very distinguished, so they'll have to forgive me for relatively short introductions, but I just want to have lots of time to hear what they've got to say. First, I'll mention or introduce rather Tessa Khan, who is the founder of Uplift, a group whose mission it is to support the movement for a just and fossil fuel free UK. She's an international climate change and human rights lawyer, and previously was co-director of the Climate Litigation Network. And she's worked all over the world, Thailand, Egypt, where I am now, India, US, Netherlands, Australia. So welcome, Tessa, thank you. We also have Ed Miliband MP, Shadow Secretary of State for Climate Change and Net Zero, former leader of the Labour Party, and was Secretary of State for Energy and Climate Change when the groundbreaking UK Climate Change Act became law in 2008. And Ed also represented the UK at the 2009 COP in Copenhagen. And then third member of our panel, by no means least, is Tamara Gilbertson from the University of Tennessee. She's an activist and a scholar and is currently the Climate Justice Programme Coordinator at the Indigenous Environmental Network, which she's worked with for over 15 years. And Tamara's been to at least 10 COPs, she told me earlier. So she's certainly an expert about that. So, what I wanted to do first of all was just set the scene, just so you know we're all in the same place. Where are we with the climate crisis? I think I might start with Tessa, if that's okay. You know, what would you say to the audience about, you know, your view of where are we in this kind of ongoing, growing climate crisis?
I know this is an answer that we've heard before, but I do genuinely think we are at a critical juncture. And, you know, that's a juncture that's going to last, I think, for the next 5 to 10 years. You know, we've heard before how important the next decade is. You know, we know, for example, thanks to the UN Environment Programme and other experts, what we need to do by 2030 to get on track for 1.5 degrees. Or well below 2 degrees of warming as a target, and that interim target is as important, if not more important, than the 2050 net zero target that often gets talked about, because climate change is a cumulative issue in terms of the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere being the problem, not how much we're emitting at any given point. And so we know that we have to halve roughly global greenhouse gas emissions by 2030, and all of the reports that came out in the last week confirmed that we are currently on track to reduce emissions by about 1%. So we're a long way from where we need to be. I think that's probably one of the starkest ways of illustrating how far we have to go. I guess there's, you know, something to be said about the fact that we finally bent the curve downwards, but there is a massive lift that has to happen over the next 8 years or so, and some people have to work a lot harder than others for lots of reasons. So yeah, I think that's where we are at the moment.
Great, yes. Every day, every month counts. Ed, can I come to you next? Like, how do you see our position?
I completely agree with Tessa, Damien, which is we're miles off where we need to be. We're heading for 2.8 degrees. We've got a trail of broken promises from Glasgow, of countries, you know, the one-year ratchet, which people remember from Glasgow, turned out not to be much of a ratchet. But, and this isn't to be sort of contrarian, indeed, I think maybe we probably share this on the panel, I think there is one thing that is very different than if we'd been having this conversation some years ago, which is the situation is much more urgent, but the economics is massively on our side. I think that, you know, the way I put it, and it's not my phrase, is it's now cheaper to save the planet than destroy it. And I think it's really important that all of us in the movement take this message out to people. We're the people for not just saving the planet, but lower energy bills, because it's cheaper in 90% of the world to have new renewables than it is to have fossil fuels. And, you know, so there's lots and lots of reasons for pessimism and lots of reasons to be really frightened about where we are. But there is also reason for hope.
Fantastic. I'll come to Tamara next. I mean, certainly here in Egypt, I've met, you know, lots of people who've come from every corner of the world, many of them suffering the impacts of climate change right now, of course, and they're getting worse. But, you know, from your perspective, how do you sort of characterise where we are right now in the sort of unfolding of the climate crisis?
Yeah, I think we are. I would agree with the other panelists. We're definitely at a juncture. We have to see real action now. And it's not just about money either. It's not just about necessarily where the money comes from. And I know there's a really big focus on finance, and we have to talk about that. I think we can't not talk about finance and funding in this conversation. But I think that there's a real lack of substantive change that's happening. And especially, you know, it's dangerous given the political ramifications of what we're seeing and how climate change is continuing to perpetuate inequalities in the world. And that when we talk about finance as well, and I hope that we do at some point, and how those financial mechanisms are actually also a cause of climate change. You know, this is not direct funding to communities. In fact, it ends up being financial mechanisms that allow fossil fuels.
Who's this?
Sorry, I'm just going to say, Bridget, can you mute?
Yeah, hi. Oh, well, look, yeah, you're not supposed to be on the
sorry,
on
let me
the
just, panel,
so,
can I do that?
Yeah, hold on a moment, yes, I'll send it to you in a second.
Excuse me.
We've all been there.
Yeah. Okay, there we go. Now you're muted, Damien.
Now Damien, you're muted.
I'll just keep talking then.
Sorry, thanks, I'm back. Yeah. You think after 3 years we'd be good at this stuff, wouldn't you? Anyway, forgive me. Let's carry on. Tamara, have you finished your excellent points?
My last point was that I also do want to say that I'm in agreement with Ed. It's we have a real opportunity here to shift things. And there are ways to do that. We do have the answers. We do have solutions. And that's coming from the ground up. That's coming from local communities, indigenous peoples who have 80% of the biodiversity on the planet, on their lands. And, you know, we all owe them a massive debt of gratitude, because the planet would have been in shambles quite a long time ago without indigenous peoples' very hard work.
Absolutely. Fantastic. I know in our newsletter, actually, which goes out every week, we had a couple of very prominent Indigenous leaders, one from Latin America, one from Africa. And it's very powerful because they've got that kind of lived experience of being very close to these things. OK, listen, we set out where we are. Let's talk about how we can get out of the mess. There's obviously lots of different ways we can talk about this. There's politics, there's economics, there's technology, there's the finance. So I'll leave it up to you which ones you want to kind of focus on. But Tamara, do you mind? You sort of mentioned finance. So why don't we kick on with you for the next bit? It's certainly a big focus here at COP26. So what are the sort of positives and negatives around that financial discussion?
There's a lot of talk, of course, about loss and damage. There's a push for a loss and damage finance facility. However, the name itself sort of gives it away. If it ends up being a finance facility, like we've seen in other types of adaptation or other types of funding mechanisms, you know, these are ways that big multilateral development banks look for a return. This is not free money or money to local communities. And in fact, the UN ends up using intermediaries to sort of decide what type of projects get funded. And then the banks that are funding them expect money back. So this is not actually getting to the ground. And I've heard over and over and over in the last week and a half from Indigenous communities in the Global South that they don't get the money. The money is often funneled through the state or the subnational state. The money does not get to the people. They're not actually the ones who make the decisions, but yet they're the ones who have the solutions. And so when we talk about finance, I think we have to really make a very clear distinction that there's a difference between funding and grants, and a difference between finance and large multilateral development banks, the World Bank, and other types of programs that obfuscate the real damage that's being done.
Right. Okay. Yeah. No. I think I've certainly heard that here. And one of the issues is that some of those vulnerable countries are really heavily indebted already, not least after the COVID pandemic. But Tessa, can I come to you next? So, I mean, you know, take it broadly. Kind of what do we need to do to get out of this mess? What are the top items on the agenda for trying to get us out of this climate crisis?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it depends which mess you're talking about. I think, you know, there's the financing mess, which is quite distinct in a lot of ways from the mess related to the kind of physics of climate change, which is quite simple, actually. We know that climate change is being driven by the burning of oil, gas and coal. They're responsible for more than 80% of greenhouse gas emissions globally. And so we know exactly what we need to do to address the bulk of the problem, which is to stop burning fossil fuels. How we do that, I think, is, you know, the more interesting question. But, you know, as Ed said, the economics in our favour are pretty astonishing at the moment. In the UK, the cost of generating electricity from wind and solar is 9 times cheaper than the cost of generating it from gas. And all of the major renewable energy technologies, or the 4 big ones, solar, wind, batteries and hydrogen electrolyzers, they are all on very steep learning curves, which is to say that the more of them you make, the cheaper they get. So, you know, we're in this extraordinary position and era where, you know, in most countries and regions in the world, coal is no longer cost competitive. So the economic forces are clearly in our favour. All of the other benefits, of course, of stopping the climate from warming any further, you know, it's not just about damage to the environment or to ecosystems or to property. It's about very real health impacts that we can ensure that we avert in terms of the air pollution caused by burning fossil fuels. Tens of millions of people die every year as a result of air pollution. You know, so the benefits are countless and it's now cheap to do it. So I think that, you know, that is the narrative solution to this problem. And then I think the question that is then outstanding is, well, how do you get rid of the incumbents? Because they are the block, whether they are you know, political incumbents or
Let's come back to that. So I want to come back to the obstacles. Let's set out the solutions here. So let me come to Ed next.
I very much agree with Tamara and Tessa, but let me say three then very quick things, Damien. First, are we going to learn the right lessons of what we've seen in the last year, the energy bills crisis, Putin's war in Ukraine? Because I think we can either look back at this and say, yes, the world learned the right lessons, which they need to get off fossil fuels fast, or, as some people would do, let's double down on fossil fuels as somehow the answer. And so that's point number one. Point number two, we have a commitment in the UK for a 2030 clean power system, so zero carbon power by 2030. I'm going to be at COP later on this week, and we really want to form a clean power alliance with other countries who are also in a sprint for clean power, because I think that is the sort of foundation. You know, if you think about the way net zero became the dominant issue over the last decade or so, I think this is now the dominant question, which is, can we decarbonize our electricity systems as the linchpin of a new system? So that's secondly. And then thirdly, just briefly, look, this has got to be the COP where we start to deliver on some of the promises that have been made to poorer countries. Because we're never going to solve this problem globally. We don't have an alliance of ambitious developed countries and vulnerable countries putting pressure on all big emitters. And, you know, I welcome the fact that loss and damage is on the agenda at COP. It does need to be discussed, and we need to, you know, come forward with the right mechanisms. Mia Motley, the Prime Minister of Barbados, is putting forward really important ideas on this, but I take seriously, very seriously, what Tamara said. But, you know, if this is a COP that it seems like from afar is less focused on mitigation, that's not great. But if it can really get to grips with some of these issues of finance, and if that is a focus of this COP, then that might be a good thing.
Yeah, that's interesting. There's a word that's coming up quite a lot here is trust, right? So the basis of trust between those poorer developing countries and the rich polluting countries is finance, because they promised 100 billion, as we know, you know, almost 10 years ago, haven't delivered it. So those kind of poorer nations are saying, well, why should we, you know, develop in a clean way? You know, we've got people without electricity if you don't meet your promises. So that seems to be that seems to be part of it. Listen, we've obviously talked about some solutions there, very cheap green technologies. I've heard people say make the green thing the easy thing. You know, that's the way forwards, which I think kind of fits into your point. But the question that might come up in some of the readers' minds is, well, if we have all these great ideas, like, why aren't we there already? You know, as Tessa pointed out right at the start there, you know, emissions are basically going to be miles above where they need to be in 2030. I've got another story coming out tomorrow, which will shed some bad news on that around oil and gas plans. And there's a global carbon budget, the amount for 2022 coming out on Friday. And I can tell you that's not good news either. I might actually come back to Ed, if you don't mind, because I think some of the problems are in the political sphere, which is your sphere, but you may choose to talk about some other areas. So, you know, why aren't we making the progress when we know what needs to be done? There are these co-benefits that Tessa talked about in terms of air pollution. It seems like, it obviously isn't, but I'll say it, it seems like a no-brainer. So why is it not happening?
I mean, look, there's lots of reasons, Damien. I mean, there is, you can't ignore the vested interests in this. I mean, you can't ignore the fossil fuel vested interests, who either, you know, ignore the problem, greenwash the problem, or make heroic assumptions about how we can carry on with business as usual and then magically sort the problem in 20 years' time. And there's sort of different varieties of that you get from different fossil fuel interests. And, you know, that has influence on governments and all around the world. And so, you know, I mean, sort of the biggest thing I would say is there's a sort of set of vested interests. Secondly, change is hard and it's easier to carry on doing the old thing than do the new thing. And in any transition, there are costs and benefits. And, you know, that's the role of government to sort of manage those costs and benefits. And then we've touched on it already. And then thirdly, I think the shadow of sort of inequality hangs over this. You know, lots of poor countries that have massive debt burdens are facing some of the worst of the climate crisis, you know, are saying, hang on, you know, how are we going to adapt to this? How are we going to be part of this? But the truth is that actually, you know, the G20 are responsible for 80% of emissions. So, you know, it's the richer countries of the world that, you know, are responsible for the lion's share of emissions. And, you know, but it's hard. It's hard to change your whole basis of your economy for the last, you know, up to 300 years. But, you know, there are lots of interests that don't want us to change either.
Can I just a quick follow-up there? How as a politician do you bring people with you when you're saying that, yes, there's some upfront cost, but it's really worth it? It's going to save your packet and energy costs.
I sort of think it goes to what I said earlier, which is, look, we're in the better lives business, and we can credibly say that this is the route to better lives. You know, just think about, for example, our clean power commitment. Lower bills, we can definitely say it will be lower bills than sticking with fossil fuels. It's a big source of jobs in the future, the green economy, and there is a global race on the Inflation Reduction Act. The Biden Inflation Reduction Act is another reason to be optimistic, I think, because it will not just have an effect in the US, but I think it will have a sort of multiplier effect on other countries. It's definitely more energy security than relying on imports of fossil fuels from goodness knows where. And it's right for climate and on your costs point, you know, there's nothing more costly than storing up this climate breakdown for future generations. So, you know, I'm not saying it's easy, but can I just make one other point, actually, which is, I think there's something quite significant about the fact that Rishi Sunak went to COP27. Not because it says anything about Rishi Sunak. People who are maybe watching not in Britain might not know this, but he initially said he wasn't going to go, and then he did go. And I think it says something. I've been sort of reflecting on this. I think it says something about the fact that, at least in the UK, sort of not being at the table is kind of not on, really. And I think that's just where the public is. I think it's that, you know, if he just decided to go, we wouldn't have had this kind of experiment in deciding not to go. But I think there is something interesting about it.
Yeah, and no, I think I agree with you. I think a few years ago, he could easily have skipped it and not really felt the pressure. And I think that feels like it's changed. But let me come to Tamara. So what we were talking about was, you know, we talked a bit in the last section about these sort of positive ways forward. But obviously, we are nowhere near where we need to go. I watched Antonio Guterres, the UN Secretary General, just a couple of days ago, saying we're on a highway to climate hell, right? And, you know, he wasn't joking. So why aren't we, you know, speeding on down the other highway in the right direction? What do you see as the big obstacles to proper climate action?
Yeah, great question, Damien. I'm really excited to sort of dig into this one with you as well. I mean, Antonio Guterres as well said yesterday that he said, quote, "We must have zero tolerance for net zero greenwash. Today's expert group report is a how-to guide to ensure credible accountability." And what he's talking about there is that the private, like, I think also sort of a big theme right now in this COP is this huge push to get the private sector in. So certainly the big banks are still involved in the financing, but bringing in the private sector is incredibly dangerous. That's not going to actually keep fossil fuels in the ground. So the big, you know, from our perspective, you know, the big obstacles are the full solutions, period. So whether we're talking about carbon markets that have not performed for almost, 20 years, 15 years, 17 years since the big carbon market started in 2005, they were launched and with pilot projects in 2003, we have not seen them reduce emissions at source. And in fact, we've seen the biggest polluters in the world profit off of them with windfall profits. As the markets come up and down, they're able to bank credits. In addition to that, we're seeing, and I disagree with you, Ed, here on the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act has a big tax break for CCS, for carbon capture and storage, which is called the 45Q tax breaks, which allows polluting industries to take, I think it's $80 per ton of CO2, but the CCS is not what they say it is. 96% of all carbon capture and storage in the world is through what's called enhanced oil recovery, or EOR. And that is compressing air, basically some CO2, to put in the ground for the purposes of bringing up more oil and gas. And that is not in the accounting. So, and I can go on and on about the false solutions. And these are the barriers. And this is what we're seeing, whether we're talking about carbon markets, forest offset, red programs, so-called nature-based solutions, which is, we're in a narrative war with these big corporations that have for decades now tried to, you know, basically give disinformation to the public. These do not keep fossil fuels in the ground. And so I also want to lift up a really great initiative called the Fossil Fuel Nonproliferation Treaty Initiative. And that's something that many of us are working on really hard. The government of Tuvalu has now lifted that up and, you know, signed on to pushing that forward. The real solutions are keeping fossil fuels in the ground. They are not these false solutions that include carbon capture and storage, hydrogen as well, which you need natural gas to make hydrogen. It's made from hydrogen, from natural gas. And I can go on and on. Of course, there's pink hydrogen from nuclear and all of the colors of the rainbow. And we can go on about that. But again, these are very misleading for the public. So what we need is to keep oil, the fossil fuels in the ground. We need this just transition. We need to listen to the solutions from the base, from the grassroots, from Indigenous peoples. And we need to start this transition yesterday, and we don't have time for this. Also, one last thing, sort of building on this greenwash theme, is President Biden, or sorry, Kerry today, basically yeah. announced the energy. What was it? What is he calling it?
Energy something accelerator,
acceleration,
wasn't it?
Plan. Yeah, energy, which is a carbon pricing system, voluntary offsets, bringing in the private sector, Bezos, Amazon, basically to do net zero projects. And they'll make money off of this. And again, we're stuck in the same place we were almost 20 years ago with big corporations making money off fossil solutions. And the greenwash has to stop now. We have no more time for this.
No, well, thank you, Tamara. I think on the Kerry plan today, I just didn't really understand it. It was saying we'll just take carbon emissions from one place and put them somewhere else. It wasn't reducing them at all. I mean, the other thing, I actually bumped into Mark Campanale, who's been at Carbon Tracker, who's been involved in the fossil fuel non-proliferation treaty today. And I think maybe it's just worth mentioning to the audience that the idea behind that is that every country kind of creates an inventory of the fossil fuels they have. So at that point, you can start saying, okay, right, we'll start doing these cuts in this sort of fair way. Because at the moment, there's not really any incentive for one country to stop because they just think, well, another country's going to go ahead. But anyway, listen, Tessa, we kept you waiting. But in terms of the blockages, the obstructions to, you know, all these sensible things that could happen, I know you kind of focused quite a lot on fossil fuels, but maybe there's other things as well. But yeah, tell me what you think about what's holding us back.
Yeah, I mean, I do focus on fossil fuels, and we've heard a bit about that already. So I might just quickly actually say something on the finance dimension, just because I did used to work on development finance, and it feels like we're having a lot of the same conversations that people within the broader development community have been having for decades around how to close financing gaps. And certainly, you know, there are assessments done after the Sustainable Development Goals were adopted about what the financing gap is there. And it's something like $1.5 to $2 trillion a year. And in the wake of that, because of course, you know, ODA aid from rich countries to developing countries is orders of magnitude smaller than that. You know, how we can bridge that gap. And there are lots of ideas, you know, innovative financing ideas, starting from airline levies to financial transaction tax to special drawing rights at the IMF that could raise billions, hundreds of billions of dollars a year. So I think, you know, there are mechanisms that people have already thought about that are kind of oven ready if we're looking yeah. for ways to bridge that finance gap that doesn't require us taxing people more, which, you know, seems to be the big political block. So just to, I think, flag that that's not a hopeless conversation at all. I know that it feels like we're banging our heads against the wall because it comes up all the time, but there are a lot of ideas, I think, that are worth exploring. And that indeed, you know, France has an airline levy, I think, that raises significant amounts of money every year, and lots of European countries have a financial transaction tax, etc. So there are precedents for these kinds of things. So that's just to say on that side, I think we know, you know, what some of the solutions might be. As for the block, I mean, I do have to say that I think, you know, the one industry that stands to benefit from the status quo is the fossil fuel industry. And the big mistake is that we keep treating them as a good faith partner in the transition, and they are not. And we have plenty of evidence from the last decades of all of the ways in which they've obstructed action on climate change, spent billions of dollars lobbying against climate policy. And, you know, even today, of course, we have all of the evidence of the disparity in their marketing budgets around their renewables investment versus their actual investments in renewables. And I think, you know, the fossil fuel industry has moved from a discourse of denial to delay, but, you know, that's not my language. But, you know, I think we need to be really careful about taking them seriously as partners in the energy transition. And, you know, in a country like the UK, where, you know, notionally we have, you know, we don't have a state-owned oil and gas company, so you expect a bit more separation, I think, between state and industry. And yet there is, I think, an assumption that the oil and gas industry will lead the energy transition. There's an acceptance that the transition needs to happen. But 3/4 of the oil and gas companies that operate in the UK currently invest £0 in renewables in the UK. And of those that do, a chunk of that investment is in order to power their oil and gas rigs using renewable energy, not to put renewable energy onto the grid. I mean, we just have to be honest about, and I think, you know, the International Energy Agency and others have made it really clear that, you know, in 2020, 2021, the capital expenditure of these companies was 90% plus still on oil and gas. That is their business model. That is what they're doubling down on. Every oil and gas company thinks that they're going to be the last one to extract the last barrel of oil out of the ground. And so I think that that's something we've really got to interrogate, because it's, you know, I think one of their last life rafts for maintaining legitimacy within the debate. And until we expose them, you know, as I said, for the bad faith actors that they are, they will continue to be taken seriously and treated respectably and continue to shape policy formally and informally, I think.
I mean, can I just add to that, Damien, because I think this is very...
Of course.
As always with Tessa, she's sort of bang on. But, you know, I think there's something sort of rather interesting that sort of arises from this, which is we often say that the way the fossil fuel companies behave is unethical. I also think it's powerful for us to say it's uneconomic. I mean, we've had this debate in Britain about fracking. Fracking was the government's policy for about 7 weeks, and then it got dumped. Now, it partly got dumped because, you know, local communities don't want it. But part of the reason local communities don't want it is because they said, hang on a minute, this is like potentially dangerous in a country like Britain, and it's like not going to do anything for bills. So what in God's name are we doing this? And so, and I think, you see, I think if I was in a fossil fuel company at the moment, I'd be quite worried, because I'd be thinking to myself, hang on a minute, it's one thing for us to be the unethical bad guys, but for us to be the uneconomic bad guys is kind of bad for us. And I think it's really important for our arguments that we put both, that this about both buckets here.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I think there's obviously two halves to that kind of uneconomic side, because at the moment, of course, they're making massive profits. So it's uneconomic for bill payers.
Understood.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I wrote a piece not that long ago which looked back over the last 50 years and worked out that oil and gas companies alone had extracted $1 trillion a year on average in unearned profits, like what economists call rents. And it's interesting here at COP, actually, Mia Mottley, who is the hugely impressive Prime Minister of Barbados, was mentioned in her speech, you know, why not tax 10 cents in the dollar, right, just straight into a loss and damage fund. So I think that, you know, fossil fuel companies are certainly coming under a lot more scrutiny than they perhaps did in recent years. Listen, time's ticking on. I definitely want to get to the questions. Again, to the audience, please do send a question. So we are going to get through as many as we can. Just one last round with the panel, which is that obviously, you know, everybody watching and everybody in the world really recognises that this is 2022 is a very difficult year in many ways. There's Russia's terrible war in Ukraine, which has driven up energy prices. There's inflation, economic problems, cost of living problems. There's geopolitical tensions between, you know, China and the US and a whole bunch of other ones, which, you know, some people might see as a distraction. Let's deal with these things first. So maybe relatively briefly, so we can get some questions, but let's, you know, tackle that. Are these issues that need to be dealt with before we get to climate change, or do we somehow, I don't know, deal with that differently? Let me start with Ed on that one.
Sorry, I'm sorry, David, you cut out there because of my Wi-Fi. What the issues you're raising?
So what I was saying was that in 2022, there's a lot of crisis. Some people have used the word polycrisis. So the war in Ukraine, the energy bills, inflation, you know, geopolitics, all the rest of it. Are these a sort of justifiable excuse for delaying climate action?
Our proposals are the solution to them. I mean, I genuinely believe this. You know, a year ago, we were talking about one crisis, which was the climate crisis. We're now talking about an energy, for lots of countries, energy bills crisis, an energy security crisis, a climate crisis. But we're the answer to all three. I mean, I genuinely believe this. You know, just think about this in a global sense. If 90% of the world, or 95% of the world, I think, are fossil fuel importers, then expensive fossil fuels are not an answer for countries. I know I'm sounding a bit sort of, you know, just sort of singularly focused on this, but I think it is, I genuinely believe it, that if you think about what is the future of jobs and the economy, how do we have affordable energy? You know, there was this old energy trilemma about security, affordability, and climate. Well, you know, we know what the answer is. I mean, we genuinely don't know what the answer is. And I don't want to sound like just a techno-optimist, but yes, we can't ignore those issues because they're massively front of mind for people, but we're the answer.
Okay. Tamara, do you see any of these crises that I've mentioned being kind of delaying, sort of reasons for delay, or are there sort of the combined solutions that linking with climate change, or what do you think about where we are in 2022 trying to deal with this?
I think that the problems that you're talking about, whether it's war, militarism, climate, energy, I agree with Ed very much. They're interlinked. It's a systemic issue. These are systemic issues that are linked. So I would say it's not a poly issue at all. It is one big, massive problem that we can trace back to, colonial capitalist expansion, and the system that we need to address. I think, I also want to say that another way to do this is to look at how subsidies to the fossil fuel industries are distributed. Mm. And there are many, and there's some great research out there that's been done by several groups like Oil Change International, some other organizations as well, that have shown us that if some of that subsidy money was shifted into renewable energy and a just transition, that we know that the fossil fuel corporation, they're not cost effective. It's not a cost effective model. So going back to your question, do we deal with war? Do we deal with the energy crisis? Do we deal with this first, that first? And I think that there are so many examples throughout history when if one thing was dealt with at a time, that the bigger holistic question of the systemic nature of conflict and violence gets overlooked.
Okay, thank you, Tamara.
So climate change is a result of this wider problem. And so we have to deal with, all of them together because they are linked together. And climate change itself is the sort of big, one of the big broad areas that we need.
Tessa.
I think it's just worth spelling out what I think both Tamara and Ed have implied about, 2022 having these multiple crises and them all being linked to essentially our dependency on fossil fuels. But I think we should be explicit about the war in Ukraine as being literally underwritten by Russia's oil and gas exports, and that being just the latest example of us being beholden to dictators, murderous, warmongering dictators because of our reliance on oil and gas in particular. And to just sort of maybe put it into some historical context, I mean, ever since we've been dependent on oil and gas, it's just been cycle after cycle of boom and bust. In the 1970s, massive social crisis as a result of the OPEC crisis in the 1990s. And now again, this will continue to happen. We have to get off the root cause of the problem, or this will just continue to escalate. And of course, now we have, the escalating impacts of climate change alongside that. So I think actually the argument is clearer than ever, the analysis is clearer than ever, and the case is as strong as it will ever be.
Completely right.
Right, yeah, and I think I read that Russia had made about $100 billion since the war started through its fossil fuel exports, which coincidentally is the sum that rich countries haven't delivered to the developing world yet. Great, listen, let's get some questions. As I say, if you want to send some, there's certainly plenty coming in, lots of good ones, so we'll get through them. I think what I'll do with, if the panelists are okay, is I'll sort of direct each question at a person and let them answer. If the other panelists want to add something, then certainly let me know, otherwise we'll kind of move on. It's just, we've got dozens, if not scores, of questions. So let's get through them. So what I'm going to do is, I have one there, where is it? Oh yeah, from Vicky Seddon, which I think is an interesting point, and thank you for sending that, which is, How do we work together to bring as many people as possible to save the planet, regardless of their left, right political position, to make common cause? So, you know, this is The Guardian. We are the tofu eating wokerati, as was said recently. And climate change can sometimes be seen as a sort of left of centre politics issue. You know, how do we sort of work across that divide? Listen, we'll leave the US to one side at the moment, right? Kind of special case and in the middle of an election. But sort of more generally, should we start with Ed, politician? How do you cross the divide there?
It's a really important question. And I think it's a sort of reminder to us that we're in the persuasion business. And I think we are pushing, Vicky, at sort of an open door, because when you look at all of the evidence from the UK, this is a concern that crosses political parties. It's now a top three issue, climate and the environment, I believe, across all supporters of all political parties. So the public are sort of are very much there on this. And I think then the question is, people are asking, and it goes to Damien's point earlier and the excellent point that Tessa made, which is, you know, in the light of all the other crises, you know, can we solve these crises together? And I think we have to answer that yes, that's the first point. Secondly, I think it's quite important, and a lot of the lessons on persuasion say this, that we don't say to people, it's all hopeless, nothing has happened, and no good has come ever from anything that anyone has done. because I think if we say that to people, they'll think, well, maybe there's just no point in doing this, and we all are all sort of slightly, you know, there's nothing we can do. And so, you know, I don't say, well, if everybody says they're going to be net zero by 2050, that's all fine, because that's not good enough, and 2030 is what matters and all of that. But I think saying that the world has moved, saying there are solutions, I think is really quite important to persuade people to come with you. Last point I'll make is, I think nobody said this so far, this is a climate and nature crisis. Mm-hmm. And it's really important to talk about the nature part of this, because that is the thing that rightly speaks to a lot of people's lived experience and the fabric of people's lives, and connects them in a way. You know, I get excited about gigatons, and so does Damien, but you know, it's not what floats everybody's boat. And you know, we've got to talk about, you know, people's daily lived experiences.
Right, okay. And you think that should be something common to parties or wherever they are really on the political spectrum?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, yeah, so I just wanted to clarify that. Yeah. Listen, again, Tamara or Tessa, if you have burning questions, like wave your hands, but I've got a good question for Tessa, I think, so let me direct that at you. So Tony Waterston has also sent us a question, and she said, do you support non-violent direct action to push governments to take more urgent action on the climate and ecological crisis?
In short, I understand that people are feeling desperate and they are incredibly frustrated with the hypocrisy, the kind of gap between what governments claim they're going to do and then what they actually do. I also 100% accept that nonviolent direct action has played a critical role in a lot of social movements, you know, in the UK, certainly globally. You know, the suffragettes threw themselves under the hooves of horses and, you know, smashed things up. So I think it's undeniable that, you know, it's a tactic that people will consider when they feel like they are voiceless or that their voices aren't being heard. I think that on its own, it's a tactic and not a strategy, I guess is how I would describe it. Maybe that's kind of campaigner speak, so I apologize for that. But, you know, if you look actually at how big moments in social change have actually happened, it is a whole range of tactics that we need to unleash at once that speak to different people, that engage different audiences, and that kind of all push in the same direction, but that all play a different role. So I think, you know, to that extent, you know, nonviolent direct action gets a huge amount of attention, certainly in the media. But I, you know, I think that there's so much work that others are doing, that others have to do to lay the groundwork for really transformative change, and that it's only ever going to be one piece of the puzzle.
Okay. I think it's important actually for us, Tamara, to sort of respond to that question as well, because certainly in Indigenous communities, I mean, tell me if I'm wrong, but I feel sometimes that they have little other options in terms of being able to object. So yeah, answer Tony's question. Do you sort of back, you know, non-violent direct action in trying to get governments or companies held to account?
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, Tony, I don't know where you live. I'm assuming you're from the UK, but I think you have a civil right. Like, you have civil rights to be able to do non-violent direct action in your country. And those rights are maintained for good reasons. Like, you have a right to use your voice, and you have a right to speak out and organize. And you know, social change has happened through organizing. And I do agree with Tessa as well. Like, there are many different arms or different, you know, ways to make social change, and we need them all. And we need them all now. And nonviolent direct action is one way. You know, and then there are places in the world, I won't mention any of them right now, but there are places in the world where people do not have, you know, those rights to speak out or to organize for nonviolent direct action. And I think that also with the violence of fossil fuel extraction that we see in the world, there are many communities, many Indigenous peoples who are on the front lines all over the world, also in the United States, also in Canada and Alaska, who are confronted by this type of violence by the fossil fuel industries all the time. So whether we're talking about Standing Rock or Line 3 or some of the other sort of, you know, big well-known direct action spaces, like those have been really important spaces for change and for highlighting the very important issues. Another one being missing, murdered Indigenous women and people, you know, women who Indigenous women who live near extractive sites, where by man camps that are brought in to build these pipelines, etc. And these are really important issues. Also, environmental land defenders all over the world who are confronted with the violence, continued violence of extraction. So yes, I mean, if you have the right to organize and to do nonviolent direct action, I think that people should absolutely be organizing, but I think that we need to do it in ways where we get really clear messages across, where we can work to build up platforms with people, to be inclusive in how we organize, you know, in a good way, and really show up in a good way in that work.
Thank you, Tamara. Slight change of direction with the next question, but an important one. Ed mentioned that we hadn't talked about nature. Another thing we haven't talked about is farming, food and agriculture, which of course is a very big contributor to global emissions. So Julia in Fairbourne in North Wales says, what support will there be for farmers transitioning away from intensive animal farming towards crop planting? So take that quite broadly. I think Ed, maybe do you want to take that first?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I think it's a good question, Damien. And funnily enough, I was talking to the National Farmers Union in the UK about this recently. You know, we often talk about a just transition for workers, rightly, but we don't really, you know, when we talk about this, we don't tend to think about farming communities as part of that. I think it is really important that we do, first point. Secondly, clearly how we use our land is an incredibly important issue. It is not something we tend to sort of think about and talk about. To be fair to the current government, or the, you know, it was actually the 2 or 3 years ago, they've introduced something that some people would be familiar with around support for environmental land management. I think that is really important, and I think it's really important that is stuck to. But there is clearly going to be a big transition for farming communities, and the questioner is completely right that has got to be part of the debate and part of how we transition, and there has to be support for that to happen, because if there isn't, you know, we're not going to get the transition that we need, including involving land. And sorry, right. One other thing, you know, there does need to be public education. There's somebody, I think a lot of people have asked in the chat about meat eating and so on, and look, you know, I don't think it's for politicians to say everybody's got to become a vegan. I think it's more about giving people information about balanced diets, you know, eating more plant-based food and so on.
Thank you. Again, I say to the other panelists, like, if you do feel a burning point, do put your hand up. But I will keep going through the questions because I know the audience will be really grateful to you know, get their questions raised. This one is from Corinne Bertrand, question that comes up quite often. Why is overpopulation, in her words, why is overpopulation not part of this discussion? The elephant in the room, question mark, she says. I don't know, Tamara, would you be okay to respond to that? Population does come up as an issue that people raise with me, you know, through email and various other things, as being something that isn't discussed enough. But you know, what's your view about? I mean, I think actually tomorrow might be the sort of day we officially reach 8 billion people on the planet. So, but tell me, yeah, is population or overpopulation, in Corinne's words, a problem?
I think that the history of this conversation is quite complex and can be, you know, framed in a very racist way. Often the sort of inequalities of the economic inequalities in the world are overlooked in terms of how resources are used. So for example, people in the global north use something like, you know, 10, 20, 30 times more resources than people in the global south. So if we're talking about nature, like Ed brought up earlier, or we're talking about extraction, like Tessa brought up earlier, then what we're really talking about is resource use. And the people who use those resources tend to be, or by and large, are in the global north. So if we want to think about climate change, and we want to think about using quote unquote natural resources, then we need to really look at how those inequalities play out in the world. So then it's not about population. If a person in the global south has more children and they're still using less resources, but people in the global north are using more, then this is far more complex. And then also from a feminist perspective, when we get into questions around who has rights to reproduce, that starts to get become a very, very patriarchal conversation. Very, how we frame this has to be done in a way, you know, that we bring in a very, you know, strongly led feminist conversation about rights to reproduction and about rights to resources and what that means if we want to live in a world that is just and equal. And then I want to, Damien, do a shameless plug about two new reports that we've just put out that I just wrote with my interns. One is on climate finance, one is on climate smart agriculture, and we have another one coming out next week on nature-based solutions. Also want to plug Hoodwinked in the Hothouse. Check it out, little booklet on false solutions, and we just translated it into Arabic. Thank you.
Great, thank you. I just remember on the population point that I actually went reporting a trip to Tanzania when the world passed the 7 billion mark. And one of the things I learned there was, first of all, that education for girls is an absolutely fundamental right and you know, powerful in its own right, but it also leads to women generally having fewer children. And also there's a large population of women who don't have choice over the number of children they have. And so the provision of contraception to women who want it is also an important part of that conversation, I believe. But thank you for that. Brilliant answer, Tamara. I'm going to ask a question now from Tim Roots, and I think I'll point this at Tessa if she doesn't mind. So Tim says, since COP1 in 1995, government actions have been far too limited. By contrast, he says, banks can respond relatively quickly to protect their brand reputations if campaigns threaten to turn customers against them. Therefore, should campaigns prioritising the shaming of banks get them to cease funding fossil fuels? Is that a good line of attack for a campaigner, shall I put it?
Yeah, I mean, I think Bill McKibben, campaigner, has a great line about, you know, finance being the fuel by which the climate burns. So, you know, there's no question that cutting off the pipeline of finance to oil, gas and coal projects and other, you know, environmentally destructive projects is smart, in that those institutions, you know, banks and insurers, insurance companies have also come in for attack for, you know, their decisions to insure and reinsure fossil fuel projects, you know, they generally have pretty diverse portfolios. So it is conceivable that you could convince a bank or an insurance company to stop financing fossil fuels because they've got a bunch of other stuff on their books to keep themselves afloat. Whereas, you know, going after an oil and gas company, you know, that is their core business model. It's much more difficult to convince them to transform. So I think, you know, it's, and it is a strategy that's had a lot of success. I mean, you know, campaigners against insurance companies have managed to basically shift the entire European insurance market out of coal. And there have been instances of, you know, massive iconic fossil fuel projects like the Adani coal mine in Australia just struggling to get insurance. It's got, you know, a permit from the Australian government. It's otherwise got the backing that it needs, but it can't find insurance. Now, of course, you know, in that instance, it's ultimately managed to get the Indian government to provide insurance. You know, there are ways of, unfortunately, I think, circumventing a cutoff in private finance if you're really determined to go ahead with a project and if you've got a state backing you. So that's why I think ultimately we do need to target governments, because it, you know, in the absence of, you know, governments ultimately are the holders of licenses for oil, gas and coal all over the world. These are sovereign resources. And so if we can convince governments to stop exploiting them or stop permitting others to exploit them, then there is no plan B. Whereas I think, you know, that's a risk that's embedded in strategies targeting private finance. That said, I think, you know, campaigners have done an amazing job of successfully cutting off the pipeline of finance to a bunch of projects already. And I think it's super smart.
Thank you. Unfortunately, we're almost out of time, so I'm actually going to combine two things. So one is a question, and one is the parting comment I mentioned to the panelists before we started. But so the question is from Karen Kraushaar, and it's, what are some of the easiest things that a regular person can do to help slow down climate change, and what can a kid do? And I was also going to ask you guys to maybe talk about what hope there may or may not be in your view in terms of battling this crisis. So maybe, you know, just in kind of a minute each, if you have a sort of final message about what people can do, whether there's hope, that would be a perfect way to finish. And thank you very much for that. So I'm going to get to Ed first, if that's all right.
Reasons for hope in a minute.
So
the reasons for pessimism are all around us, but the reasons for hope are massive. And I was just writing some of them down. If we'd been, you mentioned the 2009 summit, Damien, the Copenhagen summit, which ended rather badly for those who know what happened, although some people think that it laid the ground for the future. But think about some of the things that have happened since then. We'd never heard of the divestment movement in 2009, hardly, because it started in sort of the early 2010s. And now it is worth, it's a sort of trillions of dollar movement, arguably. Net zero wasn't even being talked about. 90% of the world have in some sense signed up to it. I know it's not what it should be. Renewables are much cheaper for, as I said earlier, for 90% of the world. And we've just started in terms of where the cost reductions are going. And I think most of all, the biggest reason for optimism is that I think there are people all across the world who care about this issue. And that takes me to the sort of point, which is individual behavior matters, and it would be wrong to say it doesn't matter. But the most important thing people can do is put pressure in different ways on their governments to act on this, put pressure on sort of private actors. We've talked about fossil fuel companies. You know, divest your pension, make sure your pension is being well invested. There's all kinds of things that we can do as individuals, but we need governments also to be part of this, and pressure on governments is absolutely crucial.
Thank you very much, Ed. Tamara, can I come to you next on that sort of final point about, you know, what can individuals do, and do they have, you know, any reasons for hope in your view?
Yeah, I think I'm seeing a lot of, especially in younger people and students as well, this sort of like doom and gloomist versus the, you know, the sort of like sustainabilityist, you know, and like there has to be a solution. It's like this, and what I'd really like to start to see is people having the capacity more, and like, and us sharing capacity more together to really face these issues head on, because it is really serious. And, you know, these are really serious issues, and this polarization of doom and gloom, or, oh, well, this is a great solution, so let's one size fit all it. That doesn't help us. Neither of them do. So how do we support each other, sort of build community towards real action? And again, going back to Tessa's point earlier, about like using all of the tools in the box, or, you know, all of the ways forward. And that includes Ed's point about pressuring governments if you live in a place where you're allowed to do that. And then supporting communities and countries where people are not allowed to do that, and finding ways to build that up, to lift that up, and to create real lasting change. Go ahead, Tessa, you're it. Last word.
Yes, Tessa.
Thanks. So, I mean, on the question of what gives me hope, I mean, I highly recommend doing the work. Just do the work, you know, action begets hope. I think that's a truism, but I strongly believe that. And I think we'll get on in just a second to what people can do. But I do want to say more concretely that what's giving me hope at this exact moment is the fact that the cost of living crisis and its connection and the war in Ukraine, you know, the sort of common cause that's now emerging across all of those issues, the root problem of our dependency on fossil fuels, is, and we are trying to build a massive intersectional coalition that brings together anti-fuel poverty campaigners, anti-poverty campaigners, anti-war campaigners, and climate change campaigners, all to talk about the fact that it is our broken energy system and our dependency on fossil fuels that is driving all of these crises at the same time. So I think we have a huge opportunity on our hands, you know, brought about by the worst possible circumstances, to really create a kind of movement of movements in a way. I think we might have lost Damien. I'm going to abuse that slightly just to say one last thing, which is that if people are looking for something more concretely to get involved with, I highly recommend joining a campaign that Uplift is coordinating against the Rosebank oil field in the UK. It's a huge new oil field. It's three times the size of the very controversial Cambo oil field, which we collectively campaigned against, and we won that fight last year. And I should point out that, you know, we don't fight individual oil and gas fields because our strategy is to shut down oil and gas fields one by one. It's because if you pick the right fields, as we did with Cambo, you know, that led to a massive crash in investor confidence in the North Sea in the UK. And you have an opportunity to tell a really clear story about what our reliance on oil and gas does and how little benefit it brings to the UK. So stoprosebank.org.uk if you want to get involved. Otherwise, I really recommend joining, as I said, you know, one of these movements that are all coming together to talk about our energy system and the numerous benefits that we all stand to enjoy if we transition away from it rapidly. You're on mute, Ed.
I think Damien has frozen in Sharm El Sheikh, so I think it's for the three of us to sort of do DIY thanks to all of the audience for who've stuck with us for an hour. And I'd like to thank you, Tamara and Tessa, and I'd like to thank the frozen Damien as well.
Oh no, I'm frozen.
Ed, you and I are the last one standing, I think. But yeah, I'd also like to echo those thanks, and to The Guardian especially for bringing us all together and facilitating such a great conversation. I hope
this has been a Guardian online event, and Tessa and I are very much enjoying taking over The Guardian. We've taken over the newspaper, Tessa.
Yeah, indeed. I look forward to doing it again soon.
Thanks a lot, everybody.